We're settling into a comfort zone, very close to resolution of this entire situation now. Just in time, the election is now 1 month away. Momentous times are upon us. The good old days are gone. Gas in California is going close to $5 a gallon, and that is just the tip of the iceberg. The world is in ferment on more levels than it's ever been, and it's an amazing time to be here. So I'm glad that everybody's here. We're all here. We all have opportunity. We're staring opportunity right in the face. It's right there for us. We can use this time to catapult us into choosing a new idea, into experiencing unconditional love, into feeling our life is real, having real, something really happen to us, something real happen to us, experiencing the real, being unaffected by all the problems. We're right there, sitting right next to that right now, just 1 month away. And there's nothing more important right now than to continue to allow the familiarity and the comfort to settle in, to set in. And from that point, make another push. That's how it's done. Setting up a base camp. Setting up the base camp, get things organized, you get comfortable with the altitude, you're there, and then you say, okay, today, boom, we're going to make another push. Right now, there's a baseball game, playoff game going on. And I said, you know what? Let's do taping instead. Let's do taping instead. Game's not looking good anyway. Just like the world is not looking good. Is the world going to make a comeback? No. Not back to the so-called good old days where, which weren't so good in the first place. But as far as the decay in this on this planet goes, now there's a long, long, long laundry list of things that are going to happen. That it's all been set up. The underpinnings have been set up, and that's not a joke. It's not a joke. And yet, what we're doing here is also not a joke. In fact, it is profound, because we're laying bare the bones of what it is that is getting us to continue to wait for something that will never happen. And just ask ourselves, how are we proud of that fact, that we're just waiting for something that will never happen? What do we expect to get out of it is the question. We won't get anything out of it. So why do we have pride in that? We have pride in nothing, huh? Kind of a stiff-necked pride, you know, stiff upper lip. Pride in nothing. So why do we have this pride? For what reason? How long are we going to stand on that pride as our foundation? How stable of a stand is that? It's a house built on straw, is what it is. Like every day we say, I can handle nothing, a little more of nothing. I can handle one more day of nothing. And of course this day, we say, we wonder, we waited our whole lives for this day. Turned out to be nothing. Not really anything. Not what we really want at all. And yet we've waited our whole all for this, and we're going to wait again. Maybe we just don't want to admit how foolish we've been. But it's not really that we've been foolish. We didn't realize how self-deceptive we could be. We didn't realize it. It's We're not insane. We're not foolish. We are simply severely deceived and intimidated. And it, so it causes us to act in what seems to be very foolish ways. And yet that's what people do when they're extremely intimidated. The Stockholm syndrome of people identifying with their captors and the belief system of their captors and prisoners, right? That is like what we're doing. We're identifying with belief and going along with belief, believing that belief will one day have some power over reality. So we're kowtowing to belief. We kowtow to belief. And no matter how we break it down and see through it, we still have this nervousness about maybe belief might succeed, and then what's going to happen to us if we have rejected belief? Then it's going to reject us. If it ever gets into power, it will reject us entirely. And so we hold out some little exception where we don't want that overlay with unconditional love. We want to toss a bone to belief and say, belief, I didn't completely abandon you. So we're not willing to completely abandon belief. It seems to have some sort of potential power, because we're the one giving it potential power. And it's very difficult for us to accept that we don't have the power to create power. And therein lies the wavering. We waver in the wind. There has to be a step that might seem frightening, you know. And citing, you know, no, I'm going to drop belief. I'm going to go with belief right now, and that's it. And I'm going to have everything overlaid. I'm going to leave nothing for belief. I'm not going to give belief even a second of right now. I'm not going to even hand over one moment of right now to belief. Not even one moment. And then you've gone all in, 100%. That's what's required. Not anything less than that. You're handing over right now to belief, and then belief immediately spins that into time and space and plausibility, and you're lost. And it seems as though belief has some sort of potential power. Even though it does not. We can see it doesn't, but do we know that it doesn't? Potential power, right? So there has to come a time where we simply decide to go all in. That's what Ramana Maharshi did. He lay down on the floor and said, okay, I'm going to die. He went all in. And he said, I'm going to have my body. My body's going to die, and I'm just going to observe it all. He just went completely all in, and then the fear of death vanished for him after that. And he realized it was all just, you know, make believe, making, made from belief. Existence, the universe, is make-believe. And yet we believe make-believe has a potential to become a power. Even greater power than reality. Because it just dismisses reality altogether. You know, completely ignores it. And we're not sure if is that a power or not. Is that really a power? Because that's what belief does. It absolutely dismisses and ignores reality. And so we're trying to determine, is that really a power or not? So all of us are capable of seeing the situation. We're all capable of going beyond belief. And we're all hesitating. That's to be expected. So the hesitation has to be looked at, and looked at, and looked at, and looked at. And it seems like it's never enough, were never really prepared for what could potentially happen. How do you prepare for what just potentially could happen? But God did not create potential. God created reality. So where can potential make-believe get its power from? Only from us entertaining it. This is something that we need to have some kind of revelation, you know, of this. Conceptuality will only take you so far. There has to be something that crystallizes, that clicks, and where we see, we recognize that we're the ones that are entertaining make-believe, and there is no other source that is entertaining it. That is where we get tripped up. We believe that make-believe comes from some other source. There's some other source that is influencing it. There's some other causal agent that's also at play. That is not true. There's only one causal agent at play in make-believe, in belief. So we're back to the single causal agent. The belief is that there's two. And so belief is fighting this battle to protect itself, saying there's a second causal agent, and that belief is necessary to undo this second causal agent. If it was a real, and that is the trick, because it the second causal agent, it comes from belief. So belief says it has to undo this. And yet, where does belief come from? It comes from us. It comes from spirit. Hello, cat. That's the problem. There's the problem. Okay, great. Great, we finally identified the sticking point. It is belief that believes there's two causal agents in belief. And so it says that belief has to take care of that second causal agent, get rid of it. But it's not a causal agent. It's a belief in a causal agent. That's the trick of duality. Duality tricks us. And so we believe, we believe that belief has some power over causal agents if it can get rid of this, and we think it, believe it has to, forgetting that we're the ones that are giving rise to belief. We're the real causal agent, not belief. And there's only a single causal agent of the dream, of belief, not two. Did you get all that? It probably sounds like difficult to comprehend exactly, but we're afraid of the potential that belief has. Because we're investing in belief. We're the ones giving rise to belief. And we believe that this second causal agent came from belief. Therefore, belief is the only one that can get rid of it. And that somehow this has to happen before we can then drop belief. So it seems to us that belief is like necessary. It's something necessary. Until it accomplishes something, we need belief to accomplish something that only belief can accomplish. And the resolution is to realize there isn't a second causal agent in the dream. This destructive dynamic comes from a single causal agent of constructivity and destructivity. One causal agent of wanting, desiring to be prime creator gives rise to this attempt to manufacture a threat to reality. And in order to do that, we have to have constructivity arise and then destructivity strike it down as a way to enact this threat to reality, like a play, to enact it within belief, to believe in it. And yet belief claims that this destructivity is coming from a separate causal agent. And we are perplexed by this, and it but this fits in with what we desire, a threat from outside coming in, right? The plan to threaten reality would be a threat from outside reality coming into reality, threatening it. And we give our authority of the dream over to belief, so because belief seems to be the one that can deal with this second causal agent by disbelieving in it. However, the real disbelieving in it is to disbelieve in belief, and only we can do that, because we have to believe that there's a second causal agent, you see? So we're turning each moment over to belief and asking belief to save us. That's what we're really doing. We're asking belief to save us, and not realizing that we can save ourselves from belief. We're asking belief to save us from the second causal agent that seemed to come out of nowhere and is striking everything down. Not realizing that this is the purpose of the dream in the first place. So duality means two causal agents arising from one causal agent. That's not possible. We believe that somehow one causal agent had effects that split into two causal agents. Double causal agents, like twin causal agents from one causal agent. That is not true. It's only believed in. It's only believed in. And we believe that the splitting of the two causal agents, now one of these two causal agents has to deal with the other causal agent and get rid of it. So there's only one causal agent, and then we can see there's only one causal agent, you know, and resolve the whole situation. So there is the trick. That is what stops us. Meditation on this, contemplation on this can resolve the situation. We don't have to get the answers immediately. You can just be willing and determined to look at this and realize that there is this clever trick, self-deception, that we are frantic about putting all our authority, trying to put all our authority into one of the causal agents, so-called one of the causal agents in this belief system, so it can defeat the other causal agent, which seems to be trying to defeat the first causal agent. That would be like God saying to Spirit, you need to protect me from some terrible threat to reality, so I give all my authority to you, which is what we desire. That's the desire, right? Desire to be Prime Creator. We desire the Prime Creator to give all its authority to us. So we are enacting this out in the dream by giving all authority to this supposed constructive part of the dream to protect itself from the destructive part of the dream, instead of simply deciding to drop the idea of trying to be Prime Creator and thereby exchanging this dream of double causality, which is just a dream, exchanging that to the effect of unconditional love that arises from not trying to be Prime Creator. So this situation is resolvable. Duality is resolvable. And we have been getting a bead on that. We've been closing in on it. Just in time. We have 1 month before the election. We have to get there. Or somebody has to get there. Could be me, could be you, could be anyone. Someone has to get there and get momentum going in October. You know? There may be some who are viewing this video who are actually going to get there first. That's fine. Anyone can get there. But momentum, we need to establish momentum. Duality has to be seen through and resolved. And momentum has to be established. There has to be a satsang, an inquiry. There has to be a starting point for the momentum. There has to be an awakening, there has to be that which is clear and awakened and an unconditional love. There has to be that. We cannot continue to merely build momentum on the conceptual level going forward. It will fizzle. It will fizzle. It's not strong enough. So we continue to express our intents with 1 month left, actually 31 days left, till the election. That momentum is established during October. And this the way that this is done is seeing through duality, seeing the trick, the trap that it is, resolving it, losing the fear of choosing a new idea, experiencing unconditional love, and then allowing that presence, that situation, to be here for the world, for those who want to keep their momentum going towards that. The momentum has to get going. So it is an urgent time right now. And you know, it's tough to be urgent. When I'm trying to keep pushing this urgency here. Keep a sense of urgency. It's difficult. We tend to just feel apathetic, like, we're not going to make it. Not going to make it. We can make it. It is right there in front of us. It is very much, you know, under the microscope right now. There is this dynamic of us trying to give our authority away, which is mirroring what we want the Prime Creator to do, is give its authority away to us. So we're trying to give our authority away to something else, okay, because we think that it can protect us from a threat. We want constructivity to somehow defeat destructivity. So we want heroes, the hero culture. My gosh, if you've heard the, you know, in other videos about the hero culture, hero problem, if you look at the world right now, you will see everywhere the hero culture being pushed to the maximum. And that's vital for deception and delusion, the whole hero thing. Save us from destructivity. Okay, instead of awakening from the dream. And that is what is going to be pushed. It's going to come on like gangbusters very soon. And all the damsels in distress will be patting their eyes and saying, please, we need heroes. We need heroines too. We need the heroes to arise. Where are the superheroes? Who's going to save us? You know, the whole world is going to get caught up in hero worship very soon. And if we do not have guru clarity, awakened being clarity, awakened being presence, I am presence of isness, if we don't have that, we are going to get pulled into that hero-worshipping culture on a global scale terribly. We're going to go down with a ship. So our prayer should be adamant at this time. And don't slack off on viewing these videos or other videos that giving you this, you know, impetus. And pray for awakened presence to be here. Absolutely. It's all important. As the vaccination, the insulation, the remedy, the protection from this hero culture that will arise, because situations are going to become so incredible here that everybody will be screaming and crying out for heroes. And of course, if you have enough clarity to listen to this, you will feel that you could be a hero, you know. Yeah, I mean, that whole thing gripped me in the past, because I knew what was coming in the world, and that gripped me for a while, for quite some time, thinking that maybe I needed to be a hero, you know, And I've had enough time to work through it now, where I'm not as vulnerable to it. But I know how severe it can get. We have a sort of an inborn thing in this dream to act in a heroic way instead of awakening from the dream. And without those who are the presence of awakened beings, beings who are abiding in isness, the I am isness of unconditional love, without that presence here, how can we avoid getting pulled into the heroic? Either leading or following, right? Instead of awakening from the dream. How can we avoid it? Cannot. Not really possible. It will become, I would say, prohibitively difficult. So there should be this sense of urgency. And, you know, I'm trying to keep it alive. It's like a little flame at times. Sometimes it grows and then the fire kind of dies down as people, water gets thrown on fire. If ever we needed the fire of urgency, it's right now. Right now. And I keep pushing it. I'll keep pushing it. I'll keep pushing it. I'll keep pushing it. It's not too late. We still have 31 days. Not too late. After the election, too much distraction. Too much distraction. Even leading up to it, there's going to be a ton of distraction. A ton. I'm able to tune it out, but it's still, you know, we don't live in a bubble. And everything, you know, permeates. Collective consciousness is there, and it permeates that and is distracting. So, duality can be resolved. It can be seen through. We've done it here, but it hasn't quite resolved yet. At least in my case. But it's clear that there's a resolution there. We just have to just, you know, click, put two and two together. That's all that's required right now is putting two and two together. All right. So hang in there. And the videos will be a source of inspiration and motivation, encouragement. And we have much to look forward to in the days ahead. All right, very great. That's it for this one.